हेलो देवस्मिता।
हेलो सर, हाउ आर यू?
आई एम
गुड
फाइन।
मॉर्निंग.
गुड मॉर्निंग। यस, वेरी गुड मॉर्निंग। एंड सो हाउ वाज द टाइम द योर समर वेकेशन?
सो वेकेशन आल्सो मेंट लॉट्स ऑफ प्रिपरेशन फॉर दिस क्लासेस एंड अ लिटिल बिट ऑफ एप्रिहेंशन.
ओके ओके, दैट्स इंटरेस्टिंग। यस ट्रू, वी आर पासिंग थ्रू very critical time in human history, pandemic, and it has impacted, you know, everything, including country, culture, literature, art practices, and students, examination, teaching, learning, and economies, geographies, everything. We are teaching this paper together. And would you like to introduce us to the title of the paper and a little bit about the names of the author?
Okay, sir, we'll do that. So the paper is Modern Indian Writings in English Translation. And the syllabus includes writers. In short stories, we have writers like Premchand, and we are doing Kafan. So it has been translated into the Shroud.
This is Stories of Modern India, Kafan.
Yes.
Okay, Shroud.
Yes. Shroud, yes. And then we have Ismat Chugtai's very, what we can say, you know, something very unconventional short story, Lihaf, which has been translated into the Quilt.
Oh, this actually reminds us of a period, pre-independent period, pre-independence and post-independence, and when it comes to post-independence, Hindi theatre, National School of Drama, Andha Yug, Dharamveer Bharti, and the director whom we pay our respect and tribute, recently passed away, Ibrahim Alkaji, and so that stalwart of modern Indian theater. Yes, after Ismat Chugtai, whose a name comes to your mind from the syllabus?
After Ismat Chugtai, sir, being a woman, we can, you know, think about Amrita Pritam.
Yes.
It's Amrita Pritam's poem, okay, I Say Unto Warish Shah. So this is a Punjabi poem which has been translated into English.
Yes.
And a beautiful poem. I think it's about partition.
Uh-huh.
Okay. And I think we can connect this again with Andha Yug.
I have a vivid memory of this poem, Unto Warisha. And during terrorist period in Punjab, I was in my first year. It was 1982, and I wrote a long letter to a magazine called Dinman that was published by Times Group, and I wrote that entire poem based on Rasidi Ticket. Rasidi Ticket is that book from where, in which Amrita Pritam included this poem, and that was published in very grayscale where I was first year student. And receiving Amrita Pritam in Dinman, the national magazine of that time, that was very interesting. Thank you very much. You reminded me of the history also. Please go ahead for telling us more about other writers.
Yes. And so from Punjab, we have another writer. We have Gurdyal Singh. Okay, and this is a short story by him, A Season of No Return.
Okay.
So again, this is about urbanization and this migration that is happening, gradual migration that happens from the rural to the urbanized world.
Yes.
Okay, and the way people, you know, are caught up between the two worlds. Somewhere, you know, also alienated from their home.
Right, right.
So this is again a beautiful short story.
From Punjab, if we go down towards southern part of India, which name would you refer here from the syllabus?
We have G. Kalyana Rao.
G. Kalyana Rao.
The Untouchable Spring. This is a novel. And so you should be speaking about it.
This is the untouchable spring, a spring which you can't touch. So this actually talks about a myth and how myth and reality affects or impacts the social structure. So caste and social structure and then hierarchy and how human and dehumanization. So for that we have one prominent undelivered speech by Ambedkar, the annihilation of caste. So once we read the annihilation of caste and then come back to this novel, or we read the novel and we read that speech and we bring them together, then a new area opens up, and that's very important for all of us in India, where caste has been a serious issue and it needs to be resolved as soon as possible for variety of developmental issues, human development, economic development, and so on and so forth in our country. Yes, from Kannada to, can you take us to Odisha?
Yes, sir. So Odisha, from Odisha, we have Fakir Mohan Senapati, again a very well-known writer in Odia, and he was supposed to be one of the stalwarts of Odia literature. So his short story, Rebati, which is again about gender, it is about the cause of women, it is about the importance of women's education, it is about how the society has always, it is about a women's resistance against society. Against a patriarchal, very patriarchal orthodox society.
Okay.
So a very different kind of a story wherein, we are in this, pandemic situation, and there are many, talks and webinars that we are, I have come across where, they talk about where the topic is, the issue is about how COVID-19 or how the pandemic has actually, led to, literature, a change in literature.
Right,
so Rebati has in the background has this cholera pandemic that, spreads across a village. And in that background, this is this woman's silence resistance or silent fight to get herself empowered, to get herself educated. Again, a beautiful story, and the students will also enjoy it.
Debasmita, the nomenclature of this paper is modern. There are certain terms in it, for example, modern, then Indian, and writing in English translation. There are five key words here. Now, of course, we know that this is an optional paper. So students have to decide why should they study this paper. So as teachers of this paper, we have our huge interest in teaching it, because we think that we have been benefited. As teachers, we have been benefited by translation of different modern languages into English. So why should students study it? What is how we can evolve, both of us, we can talk about it. You begin about it. Yes.
Okay, sir. So as the paper is titled Modern Indian Writings in English Translation, so all these, so it just mentioned the five keywords. So it is about modern. Right, so modern also means the concept modern. So I think the students will be engaging into it when they again get into British literature, early 20th century, and they're again going to get introduced to the concept of modern and modernism. So apart from this concept of modernism, it is also about chronology, right? So the timing, so the time frame in which these particular writings came up. So it is also modern Indian. So that's what I was coming to. It is about modern Indian writings. So modern Indian means that we are also tracing the evolution of these languages and literature.
Right.
From the Abhramshas escape from Sanskrit rather to the Abhramshas, to Prakrit Abhramshas, okay, and via the medieval era to the modern times.
True.
So somewhere, you know, we are, you know, linking what they have or the students would have done in Indian classical literature to modern Indian writing. So how, what was, what they had studied in modern Indian, in Indian classical literature. So they will be able to link that today with modern Indian writings in English translation.
Right,
this is
right.
This tracing that they will be doing. They will be able to link what they have done in the first year to what they are doing now in the third year. So somewhere this is going to help them develop a holistic kind of understanding of Indian literature. Also.
Right, right. And you see, this is, I mean, the focus here is that it is in English translation. So translation is a bridge. It is a exchange of cultures. This is exchange of knowledge. It is exchange of variety of those cultural components which otherwise are not accessible if that language is, we are not able to access to that, that language. So we have here a whole India and Indian languages, Odia, then Bengali, and then Punjabi, Urdu, Hindi, we have Mukti Bodh, we have Premchand, then from
Manipuri.
Manipuri, yes. So in a way, it's a, it's an experience of gathering, talking, understanding poetry, literature, culture, art, history, and related issues of different parts, geographical lands, people, and culture of India. So how would you elaborate this, that that English translation of these regional or Indian languages poets by English department, and offering this paper by English department, does it not sound a little strange?
I think it does. But sir, the thing is that when we, you know, begin with the study of Orientalism and Oriental literature, I think it was the first initiative or translation of Indian languages or Indian regional languages was taken up by the English department or by English translators. So we begin with William Jones, and then later onwards also we have, you know, these the universities and the English departments, okay, the English language and literature departments of these universities take up this initiative of translating Indian regional literature into English. So that way is English, anyways, being accepted as a lingua franca, has you know, taken up this initiative of, you know, linking these literatures, regional literatures, with each other. So now, you know, that way is, you know, there is a kind of a cultural exchange, translations happening.
Right, right, right. So is it also, I mean, English is linking them, but at the same time, English also is being linked. That is the expansion of English, that is the character of Indian English is expanding. So English is no more for English department Shakespeare or Donne or Milton, but it's also Premchand or Mukti Bodh, Ismat Chughtai, or Tagore, or Bashir, and all of these writers. So in that sense, English as a language in inverted commas foreign, okay, gets renewed life and gets reinvented, recognize itself by meeting Indian languages and writers. So we
it
think
it is more Indian now. Yeah, it is Indian. It is also Indianized. English is also Indianized. It is rather it is expanding itself. So it, that way, it is becoming exclusive, and it is also inclusive because it is including in itself, you know, these regional languages and
yes, 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 true, true. And you see, a paper is not only a paper, but it's also it may everyone would like to think, well, why, what is there any further study in it, or does it help in creating some job opportunity or research, or what is it that can motivate students besides its content? I mean, how is translation? Yeah.
So one that, you know, if somebody, one of the students, you know, first is that, you know, it is actually helping one understand Indian literature. So it is giving them more understanding of Indian literature and as well as English literature, because these literatures, once they have been translated into English, so they are part of English literature also. So there is, so you get a wide range of knowledge about literature, about various kinds of literatures that are available in the world. So somewhere one gets connected to world literature also. So you know, there is, you know, a kind of a chance for students, okay, to research, to explore, you know, and do a comparative analysis of literature that is available in India with literature that is available in Latin America or in Australia or in, you know, in Africa. Right. So somewhere, you know, so though that so English being that link language has helped them, you know, will help them understand their, you know, these, you know, other perspectives of literature and language.
Okay.
The second thing that I can think about, sir, is that when they are doing this particular paper, they are reading about Dalit literature, they are getting into partition literature, they are getting into post-colonial literature. So they are, you know, they're studying, you know, genders, so feminism, okay, with Rebati and...
Smita, say all of the students, all Indians are multilingual. They speak more than one language, that we all understand. Students come from different linguistic communities, and at the same time they are studying English literature. So one thing is that at the level of resources, they are equipped with two or more languages, say Hindi and English, or Punjabi and English, or Malayalam and English, or Bengali and English. This is the profile of our students. So this paper will help them to create their own kind of writings. Say, for example, a student who knows Bengali can translate a Bengali text into English. Similarly, a student who knows Hindi can translate. Now, what is the purpose of this? The purpose that it's a wide purpose. It can create job opportunities. It can even help them to see themselves as translators, as writers, right from now. And then at the same time, in the world, the demand of Indian literature will be of this kind. Say Latin Americans would like to read our Marathi writers, or our Odia writers, or similarly. So translation, therefore, has job opportunities also. So by and large, you see, we have a whole big canvas of writers, modern Indian writers who write in different Indian languages, who have extensively contributed in developing literatures of these languages. And at the same time, we have incorporated a language that arrived from England, but as we know that human beings adapt themselves to new languages, and we made it our own language, and translation has really created a body of this literature. And then our literature in the world will reflect who we are, and how we are managing our societies, how we are managing our aesthetics, how we are in a way evolving. And we know that India has been a civilization where ideas, particularly holistic ideas or ideas of human development, have contributed to the world, whether it is these are shastras, texts, or Indian aesthetics, or yoga, or Natya Shastra, and it carries different aspects of the civilization to the world. Right, Devasmita, this conversation must end on the note with your last word. What would you like to say to our students about this paper?
Okay, one, for aspiring writers, it is going to be very helpful, because you are not just going to know about Indian language, about, you know, English literature, you also get to know about other Indian languages that you have not been accessible to, right? And the other thing is that it is going to be an easy paper. It is relatable. You are in the Indian context, you are going to read about very, you know, big terms, okay, but everything illustrated through an Indian context. So that way you are able to understand the concepts very easily. So this is the thing.
That's great. It was nice talking. Thank you very much. Okay, take care.
Thank you.
Stay safe.
Okay.
Bye.
Okay.